who began birth looking the same and then eventually become very, very different. This distinction gives rural residents land use rights, and as a result, land is developed more speculatively, more rapidly, and more haphazardly than in urban areas. Now, the reform era commencing in the late 1970s harnessed this difference. Microprocesses were synchronized with macroeconomic policy, top-down and bottom-up, urban plus rural. This was global capital through industrialization that was channeled through rural citizens. This is obviously Deng Xiaoping and Margaret Thatcher. So as a result, urban and rural processes have become intertwined. And at the same time, the rural has become more dependent on the urban. 30 years on, through researching specific project sites, we aim to identify urgent issues and contradictions that have arisen from this era of transformation. The projects facilitate research, and research reinforms the design approach. Rather than research in order to make projects, we do projects in order to do research, projects as a form of research. We have worked in over 18 villages in China, and we treat each village as the project. The village is the entity. How can our buildings transform each village that they exist within? The aim is to respond to this unique context in transition and embed each project with spaces that can adapt and respond to the volatile conditions of rural-urban transformation. So in looking back at projects, I'm going to show you 10 projects. We began to realize that because of the multiple contradictions within the context that we're working in, we have often employed contradictory strategies. Not a single approach, but a mixture, a grab bag of various different strategies that often lead to the same result with extremely different means. And our strategic responses reflect this landscape of paradox, but each is grounded in spatial and material strategies. So the first pair I want to show you is really about the difference between bottom-up versus top-down as a strategy. One is an individual prototype, and the other is a collective design. The first is designed for a house that whose goal is to influence an entire region in which all the houses exist on the same plot of land, 10 meters by 30 meters. And so you'll see in this project, education is a very big theme of the project. Now, in the last 30 years, each of these houses has undergone individual transformation through villagers adapting old traditional courtyard buildings in mud to brick. Sometimes the courtyard is eradicated completely for a three-story building. I've been teaching full-time, and the projects that we do, I work pro bono for all the projects. So professionally, I'm a teacher, and trying to involve students always within each project. This also began as a workshop in which we documented the various houses in transition. Students assembled a program and tried to understand the lifestyle that was changing, developed various approaches, spatial approaches to the notion of courtyard, and ultimately designed and built a four-courtyard house. That the whole idea was a fully integrated house which took technology, traditional technology like a kan, which is when the bed is located next to the kitchen and the smoke from the cooking fires travel through the bed, heating up the bedroom so you can eat a big meal and then go straight to bed. and really, I would say architecturally, trying to bring the idea of the courtyard as a kind of uniquely Chinese, uniquely rural source of society and economy back into the house itself. These are the different courtyards. One courtyard houses a biogas tank. It's also where the animals, the pigs, are located. There are four courtyards you'll see here. There's a backyard that's a kind of animal courtyard, the toilet, and then the pigs feed the biogas tank. There's an internal planting courtyard, which has steps leading up to the roof. There's a washing courtyard located next to the kitchen, and then a kind of front courtyard serves as parking, actually, and the greenhouse. It's a washing courtyard. All our ideas are very simple. We are very simple people. So one strategy here that was a kind of very subtle shift was looking at the old houses, which all have pitch roofs, and then, of course, they're very good for expelling rain. The new houses, built by contractors, built by people who you now the villagers are hiring to come build their houses, have completely flat roofs, and when it rains, they become swimming pools on the roof. Now, Shaanxi is a very dry area. It does have a small rainy season. So what we did was we basically inverted the roof so they could still use it as steps for drying food. And it could begin to collect the rainwater into the washing courtyard during the rainy season. The whole idea was to create a house that would express a sense of self-reliance. Also, the brick screen is an idea. I almost don't have any new ideas, but I like to travel around to observe what's going on. And this idea was from Xinjiang, which is further west of China, a technique to block the mud wall. I should tell you at this point that every year I try to quit architecture. It's gone on for so many years that it's become almost like a tradition to spend 1 month quitting architecture. And there's many crises here, and you know, when we talked about failures, I think there are failures, which I'll show you later. There are really terrible failures, which I will not show you. But in this house, you know, originally the idea was to do a rammed earth wall, and then somehow we could not convince the villagers to do it. It's very difficult with the concrete roof above. So then we decided to do the mud brick and use the brick screen instead to protect it. Then they built the brick screen like this, and I regretted afterwards, completely regretted that we hadn't allowed the roof line to show. I thought this was a big disaster. It turned out it was not such a big disaster because nobody noticed it. So there's also, I think, a lesson learned here about what to focus on. You'll see, you know, rural urban framework, if you hear it, it sounds like rough, and that's intentional because we don't know how to do fine architecture. But it's a belief that the basic elements, space, the diagram, the program, is what makes architecture what it is. And this is a model that we built in order to communicate with the contractors, to show them every single piece of the building that was built. It was a very successful model because we brought this model, we got the villagers and the builders together, and they completely convinced us using this model that it was way too complicated to build this house this way. So it worked in reverse in this case. At the end of the day, the house has had a kind of interesting history. And in this spirit, the house originally, we wanted to, the donor wanted to try afterwards to give it to one family in need. And so we selected three families, we interviewed three families, and we picked family A to live in the house because they really could be the sort of example household for this. And then, of course, the government came back and said, well, family A, they don't want to live in this house anymore. But family C, they would be really, really good, you know, for this house. So we said, well, actually, we think family B is good. And then they came back a month later and said, well, actually, family B, they also don't really want to live in this house. But family C is still available. So at the end of the day, we worked with the Women's Federation in Shaanxi, and we developed a program for the house in which women in need would live there, and it became also the base of a cooperative. The donor is a designer with her husband, and they developed straw weaving products. So they took their traditional straw weaving technique and then adapted them for sort of modern products for the market. So it is both a domestic and a public house. It's a community program and a domestic program at the same time. It's important, I think, to allow architecture to evolve. Rather than, our approach is rather than sort of making architecture which is built or built to last, our approach is about making architecture which is fit to evolve with the changing context. This is a very different project that came after this, in which the, in Sichuan, you know, the earthquake. So we had a site where in 2008 there was the Sichuan earthquake, and then villagers had spent 1 or 2 years building new houses, and then there was aftershocks for the earthquake. So right before they moved in, the houses collapsed a second time, and then they had to rebuild them again the third time. Just a moment, a pause here, where I explain how the village rebuilding process is taking place in China. The government sped up after the earthquake has been sort of en masse replacing all the traditional mud houses with new ones, and they put in funding. It happens brutally, very, very fast, and the villagers are in control. There are no architects present. So what happens when villagers have a limited amount of land and they each want to build the biggest house for the least amount of money is that it looks like this. And this is happening all throughout China. We approach 6 or 7 houses before we, before we found this village, where we could take a different approach. And our approach was the first big decision that was quite difficult, actually. A lot of this looks very natural, but in fact, you'll soon find out we're kind of rule breakers. Somehow, we break little rules here and there. We're not rule followers. It was very difficult to convince them simply to allow the topography to give rise to the plots of the houses. And then, of course, we worked with the plan to give back a small space on the ground floor for each house. We developed 4 prototypes. Basically taking the first courtyard house and transforming it into a 3-story typology. And ultimately, it's also about this kind of common landscape. It's about the common good. There is a tradition of the tabula rasa city. But now in China, they're building hundreds of thousands of tabula rasa villages. The village is something that we take for granted. It exists before time. So this, for me, is a new type of program. We have a very good, we go out and we also help to seek funding. In fact, I spend a lot of my time seeking funding. The government is providing the funding for the infrastructure. The villagers, of course, are funding their houses. And then Nanfeng, a big developer in Hong Kong, is funding the cost difference to help make the houses and to make the village more sustainable. So if you're going to rebuild after a disaster, then why not do it better than what was there before? So this becomes, there's a very interesting dialogue now between this village and how we've approached it and all the other villages which have been rebuilt after the Sichuan earthquake, which are somehow meant to imitate the vernacular tradition. For me, this is really a process of trying to remake completely a vernacular tradition, not even to think about it very much. In fact, I don't really like this word. I don't think about what is vernacular, what is not. I just think about, you know, what is available. And I think one has to continue that evolution as opposed to trying to preserve it. When we This is in the process of completion. There's a community center, there's a reed bed cleansing system that is going to be implemented. And we had designed the roof as different kinds of options in which there would be hard surfaces and that they could use for drying, and there'd be some planting areas. But the villagers really took to this idea. They loved the roof. And they wanted to basically plant on top of it because they actually don't have any land for planting their own, for their own household. That's why these villages become so dense. So the entire roof now will be used as a farmland. It's a village then which supports a kind of the farmland on top, a kind of common landscape. This is another two projects I want to share, which talks about the issue of speed and of time. Two different speeds of development. One, incremental planning versus instant urbanism. The first project is actually the first project that I began in 2006, I believe, and we're still working in this village. It's for a small primary school. You'll see that on the right. It looks very old indeed, but that's rain splotches. And then this is the original school, a courtyard building, and then this is the new school that was built. The program was to build the new school, but we worked again with very many different charities, developing various programs for education, for how to, we are a very small part in the much larger economic cycle. All the other partners are trying to help the village, which is relatively close to Hong Kong, transform its farming technique and produce into an organic one that would, you know, give better return, better yields. And ironically, this was the village that we selected because it was so poor that they hadn't polluted their land with fertilizer. So this was, when we came in, there was a lot of rice terraces. So even when, often in China, it's always about, you know, clearing the land and then building rows of buildings. It's the fastest and most efficient way. I always try to work with the land. And the form of the school is basically a cut and fill along one of these rice terraces. The idea was to basically design a new school instead of enclosing it, treat it as a public facility for the village itself. So on one side, there are steps over a covered walkway, and the village has no public space. Villages in China are extremely dense, as I suspect they are here. And this is their New Year's celebration, so it becomes a kind of main public space which faces the village. The other side faces the landscape. This is the first case of kind of rule breaking that we engaged in, subversion. All school buildings in China must have ceramic tile on it. Just that's the way it is. I guess it's about that, you know, it looks new, it looks better, somebody. Maybe the ceramic tile industry was involved. But of all the school buildings, so this is not ceramic tile. From a distance, it looks like it. But in fact, in order to save money, we got very cheap and very simple cement bricks. And then the villagers painted them different colors. The donor bought some cans of paint. I'm not responsible for these colors. Personally, partially, maybe. But that's good, because I think it really kind of fits in with their outfits, their own colors. And so something which is a kind of mass-manufactured technique that is, you know, meant to make buildings look modern is actually an event that happened in the village, a kind of hand-painted, handwork, which brings the villagers together in terms of participating on some small level in the construction of their school. This is the covered walkway beneath the steps, so, you know, when it rains, the students can use this space. They can hide from their teachers here. And this is the classroom. And this project ended up being 8 different phases with 6 different funding bodies. This is the library. Also taking this idea of the landscape, a raised floor with cutout islands. I don't know if psychologically it's because we have 2 hours, but I'm going much slower than usual. This is the old school, which we were able to transform into a community center. So we, you know, the old school was embedded right in the village. It had a little basketball court, and our task was, you know, how do we transform it? How do we program it? We worked again with a charity in Hong Kong, which wanted to make this a kind of a model household farm. So, you know, concrete screen, always trying to use materials in unexpected ways. These concrete screens are usually used, they're made for pigs usually, because they, you know, it's a very cheap way to put it in the pigsty. And then we wanted to make a whole wall out of it. This is Kaldori Farms holding a workshop in terms of helping the the villagers transform their produce. They hold the lion dance practice there. You see the concrete screen, there's 2 different patterns. And then another community meeting space. The donor is there in white. And now we've brought students there, we hold workshops there. In the front, we added these steps for plants, for seeding. So small series of interventions. Now, these two projects span about 6 years, and you'll see that in this 6-year period, the first project was the last of a type of school building. In Chinese, we call it the Xiwang Xueshao, which is the kind of hope school. And at the time that the government, in I think 1986, they mandated a kind of 9-year compulsory education. So hundreds and thousands of these schools were being built throughout China. Small rural schools far out. After the Sichuan earthquake, it was realized, of course, that these were big sources of income for the villagers. They were built very poorly, and a lot of these buildings fell when the traditional ones remained. Currently, the government has changed its education policy. So now they are building huge mega schools. The schools that I'm going to show you now are about 2,400 to 3,000 students. They often exist in villages which have less than 2,000 residents. So it's a village in itself, whereas the school before was only about 200 students. We were approached by a Hong Kong billionaire who wanted to donate and build 100 schools within 3 years. And he was donating 10 million RMB per school. Now, 100 is a lot of schools. I know initially it's a reason to get excited, but it was quite frightening for us to engage in this process. This is one of the sites. So what we ended up doing was building 2 prototype schools. And we had to design a school which had 2 very different sites. One was in the middle of a completely new town. You see here, this is about 4-meter level of earth, literally being bulldozed over the farmlands and blanketing this, and it's going to become a new city. This is the view from the school. I'm not sure if it's the same view. It's the same spot we're taking the picture after the school was built. And so one existed in the center of Newtown, and the other existed in a completely rural area in the center of a village. So instead of, you know, unlike the first school, which is really about opening up towards the village, this school is really about enclosing it, the theme of the idea of a walled city in which this students would become a community in itself. another case where all school buildings in China have to face north and south, no matter where you are. So, you know, China is a vast place in the far north or far west. That's why they're always lined up, block by block. So when we had the idea of a walled city, it was completely new, the idea of just having a square plan in which you had a little courtyard, because it broke the rules of the north-south facing. What we ended up having to do was orient all the classrooms and all the dormitories 45 degrees, so they all face the same direction, but we could get this space. And that takes, you know, about 6 months to do that, and then just 3 months to build the building. That's why our project, we're very slow architects. So we don't do many commercial projects. It usually takes us about 3 years developing the program, raising funds, working with the community, and then the construction period is actually very short. Yeah, so what we also did was we tried to think about every project as a prototype. Other architects, maybe they hate to be copied, but we love to be copied because that's when we know that we're doing something right. The idea is not to sort of, you know, I was talking to someone the other day about how in Denmark, only 10% of the buildings are designed by architects. So you can imagine everywhere else in the world, it must be a tiny, tiny fraction of buildings. So you cannot really change the world. However big the tower you build or, you know, the development you're building, it's still a tiny, tiny drop in the bucket. We're interested in how our buildings can inform and can actually have a dialogue with the generic buildings, the stuff which is not built by architects. We developed this kind of walled city with different kinds of public buildings that would push into this and activate this courtyard. The art block, the auditorium, the cafeteria. Another thing that we began to do last year was we began to go back to all our projects to see how they fared, what worked and what, more importantly, what did not work with the projects themselves. We're Josh and I, we are very kind of insecure people, so we're obsessed with failure. We're quite neurotic in that sense. We try to celebrate it and we try to learn from it. Another, I think you could say, conflict or tension is the difference between trying to work very site-specifically, often through generic construction methods, and then trying to make our projects also prototypes that can be copied. So these two, being aware of this kind of tension, not trying to do a completely unique building, but trying to do something which both fits, is very familiar in the site, and might be very alien at the same time. It kind of stands out from the site. Personally, for me, that's the quality that I ascribe to a good architectural experience, something that is both shocking and also completely suitable, completely fitting to a context. Maybe you could say the architecture brings the context, wraps the context around itself. So these two schools, one is a school, one is a hospital. In this one, this is in between the two school projects I showed you earlier. Oh, by the way, we only managed to build 2 out of the 100 schools with this billionaire. It just didn't seem like a very good idea to, since we were at the pace of, you know, one project every 3 years, to try to build 100 over 3 years. We're much more interested in quality, but actually, it has worked out well because he has now taken this prototype, he's copied it, hired the architect from our, who was working with us, and is developing it onward. This school is in the middle phase. It's about